kings, queens, CEOs, businessmen, millionaires, billionaires, athletes, musicians. That's how we judge greatness today. And Jesus is flipping all that around.
We, as Americans, and probably especially as men, we love debates on greatness, especially when, you know, when it comes to athletes. You know, for example, you know that I'm a Chicago kid, so therefore I'm a Bears fan, and I'm a Bulls fan, and a Blackhawks fan, and a Cubs fan. So you're never going to convince me that there's a better basketball player than Michael Jordan. And if you were to argue with me about that, I'm going to bring out the statistics, the points, the numbers, the championships. The same with Walter Payton, I think the greatest running back to ever play. I'm going to go back to those same very things, the stats, the touchdowns, and all those data points. What's interesting today is in comparison to how we measure greatness, how Jesus measures greatness. Bless you. And we got a taste of it this morning with the children, actually, quite intentionally. Jesus turns the way we measure greatness on its head. Would you stand with me and open up your Bibles to Luke's Gospel? We're in chapter 22. This is page 608 on your paper pew Bible if you want to follow along on paper. We're going to read verses 24 through 38. Again, Luke 22, verses 24 through 38. A dispute also arose among them as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. And he, that is Jesus, said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, let the greatest among you become as the youngest, and the leader as one who serves. For who is the greater, one who reclines at table or one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at table? But I am among you as the one who serves. You are those who have stayed with me in my trials, and I assign to you, as my Father assigned to me, a kingdom, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, verse 31, behold, Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." Peter said to him, "Lord, I am ready to go with you both to prison and to death." And Jesus said, "I tell you, Peter, the rooster will not crow this day until you deny three times that you know me." Verse 35. And he had said to them, "When I sent you out with no money bag or knapsack or sandals, did you lack anything?" They said, "Nothing." He said to them, "But now let the one who has a money bag take it, and likewise a knapsack. And let the one who has no sword sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in me." Quote, "And he was numbered with the transgressors," end quote. "For what is written about me has its fulfillment." And they said, "Look, Lord, here are two swords." And he said to them, "It is enough." Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We stand in awe that it is your will revealed, that it is history truly seen through your eyes. And yet it's incredible how your word does a work in individual hearts. So we pray that that work would be pleasing in your sight today, that you would accomplish what your word desires, to bring about conviction, to bring about joy, perhaps today, to bring about salvation for the first time. May we be hearers and doers of it, and may you get all the glory for the fruit we bear. In your name we pray, amen. Please be seated. Well, a special welcome if you're new to the church, visiting, maybe seeing the grandkids for the first time. Let us know who you are and how we can pray for you. And I would encourage you highly to take one of these "You're Invited" cards. And whether you're a longtime member, regular attender, or first time, share this with a friend. Let them know that there is an Easter service they can come to this Easter season. Our passage today, entitled simply, "Jesus Turns Greatness on Its Head," I think breaks down into three parts. Greatness redefined, that's verses 24 through 27. Perseverance required, verses 28 through 34. And finally, Jesus, the suffering servant, Luke 22, 35 through 38. Jesus turns greatness on its head. And first, he does so by redefining it. A dispute, verse 24, also arose among them as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. So right off the bat, we notice the dispute seems to be a spillover of the discussion they were already having at the end of the Passover meal. Just look back one verse to verse 23. And they began to question one another which of them it could be who was going to do this, who was going to betray Jesus. He had just said to them, "One of you will betray me." So they're having this debate. And you can imagine how it would go. I would never betray Jesus. And John says, I would never betray Jesus. I've been faithfully following him for 2 years. And Peter says, I could never betray Jesus. I've been following him for 3 years. And so on and so forth. As men often do, we measure by the stats, the data. And that moves, therefore, into who is the greatest, who is the most faithful. We as men instinctively size each other up. And I think the apostles, the 11 of them left here, I think Judas at this point is gone. They're doing it. They're sizing each other up. They're asking who's the greatest, who's the most faithful. And Jesus has been sitting here quietly. It's probably still after the meal. They may be already walking in the garden. It's not clear. Or my memory may be failing me here, but they're talking, and Jesus then chimes in. He says, verse 25, "The kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, let the greatest among you become as the youngest, and the leader as the one who serves." So Jesus sets up a contrast that's easy enough for them to understand, and for you and I think as well. The Gentile kings in that time were the Roman rulers, exercised lordship over their citizens. The root of that Greek verb, exercise lordship, is where we derive the noun Lord, kurios. It's how we refer to Jesus. It's how we refer to God, the Lord or our Lord Jesus Christ. So it's where we derive the noun from, but the verb has a negative connotation most often. And so that's how we're to hear it here. This isn't Lord in a reverential sense, but this is a Lord as one who holds authority, and you know it. The New American Standard translate this passage, "The kings of the Gentiles domineer over them." I think that's truer to the mark. So the kings of the Gentiles domineer, they rule, they exercise lordship over their people. And at first glance, the next part, benefactor, sounds better, doesn't it? I mean, after all, a benefactor benefits someone else. However, grammatically, benefactor must be connected with he who exercises lordship. And so there has to be a negative connotation here. And if we think on it, we can imagine scenarios where a benefactor can still be a negative because the cost may be that high. Well, Jesus leaves no room for doubt in verse 26. Look there. He forbids both the king, the Gentile king, if you will, the lordship and the benefactor, and says, "But not you." Quite literally, "But not you." You don't get to domineer over those under your authority. You don't get to play the benefactor at the cost of your underlings. Rather, or instead, the greatest among you must become as the youngest, and the leader among you must be the one who serves. Wow. Let's look at that first part, because it's a little puzzling. What does Jesus mean, must become as the youngest? We can't go back in age. Well, think of this verse earlier in Luke chapter 18, verse 17. "Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it." Whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like the youngest shall not enter it. So what's the connection? Jesus is again reminding us that we must have faith like a child. And as we age, we know the temptation to doubt God, to be disillusioned with how things have happened in our lives, especially as we suffer more through circumstances, through sickness. And the temptation to grow cynical is great. So Jesus says, not you, Christian, not you, follower. You must have faith like the youngest, not given to cynicism, not disillusioned, not doubting. Simple, pure faith. And you heard some of it this morning. You saw it in their faces. The other side of greatness, as Jesus is redefining it, is to challenge his disciples with what some people now call servant leadership. There's even secular writers writing on this very topic in the leadership circle. Jesus knows his apostles don't get it, so he reminds them what they believe to be right so they can more clearly understand how wrong it is. So look at what he says here in verse 22, or verse 27. For who is the greater, one who reclines at table or one who serves? Well, the answer is the one who reclines, right? Because he's hired the servant. He's paying for the meal. He has more means, more authority, etc. Again, he asks, is not the one who reclines at table? And the answer is obviously, yes, of course. But I am among you as the one who serves. But I am among you as the one who serves. So the one who is greatest in the world's eyes, and even today in all of our eyes, are kings, queens, CEOs, businessmen, millionaires, billionaires, athletes, musicians, models, beautiful, successful people. That is still how we, of course, judge success. That's how we judge greatness today. And Jesus is flipping all that around. And Jesus is using himself as an example. Now, they've watched Jesus, some of them, for 3 years. They've seen him give sight back to the blind. They've seen him cleanse leprosy, the most feared disease in the ancient Near Eastern world. They've seen him raise people from the dead, Jairus' daughter, there are others, of course. They've seen Jesus do incredible things. They think Jesus is one of the greatest, if not the greatest. In fact, it's Peter's lips who say, Jesus, you are the Messiah. You are the one we've been waiting for. So in their eyes, Jesus is the greatest. And Jesus is saying, and notice how I've acted. I've served. In fact, in John's gospel, he had washed their feet before this meal, an act only done by the lowest of the lowest servants. Because people in that day and age walked everywhere in sandals. Their feet were disgusting. You think your grandma or grandpa's feet are gross? No way. Way worse, okay? Sorry, grandmas, I should have just said grandpas. My apologies. But you get the idea. Jesus has just shown them over and over again service. And they know he's the greatest. And they've thought this is unique. And Jesus is saying it's just not by accident. It's intentional. Jesus is the servant leader. As this profound realization sinks in, as Jesus is calling them to be those who are servants rather than slave masters looking down upon their people, as he calls them to have simple, childlike faith rather than the cynicism of their age, he's also preparing them for what's to come, because perseverance is going to be required of them very, very soon. Verse 28. This occurred to me a little late, which is typical for me. I often get lost in the weeds. But kids, I want you to help me. What comes next Friday before Easter? What do we call that? Say it again. Good Friday. Good Friday is coming. And Jesus is doing his disciples, his apostles, an incredible kindness by equipping them for what is coming in the immediate and will prepare them well for the rest of their lives to come. Verse 28, you are those who have stayed with me in my trials, and I assign to you, as my Father assigned to me, a kingdom, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. So Peter, James, John, the rest of you, you've been debating about who's greatest, and I'm flipping that on its head, but I need to give you some hope. I need to give you the truth of a future reward. It's coming. What did he just say? One, because you've stayed with me. Now they're going to stumble. All of them are going to stumble here in the next 24 to 48 hours. They're almost at the garden. Jesus is going to be arrested. Jesus is going to be beaten. Jesus is going to be crucified, and very few of them are going to stick around to see all of that, let alone even part of it. So they are going to struggle with their faith. They are going to struggle with their perseverance. But friends, that's not the point, of course. Perseverance is, did you make it to the end? It's like a runner knows there are those hard spots in the race. But what matters is, did you finish? Did you finish? So Jesus gives them encouragement to finish and to finish strong. I assign to you, as my Father assigned to me, a kingdom, and you're going to eat at my table. When all is said and done and the kingdom is established in full, you are going to dine with me. Jesus had just told them, I'm not going to eat the Passover meal again. In fact, he even went further and said, I will not drink another cup of wine, which was commonly served at every meal you ever had if you were a Jew. But you, my faithful apostles, you're going to be with me the next time I have the glass of wine. You're going to sup with me. And you are going to be given authority. You're going to sit like my viceroys, my kings under me, and judge the 12 tribes of Israel. Wow. So Jesus has just redefined what it looks like to be great, and he has told them of the rewards that are coming. He's given them a glimpse of Revelation 19, if you want to write that down, the wedding supper of the Lamb. And then he looks at Peter. We've known Peter these past year and a half. We've been in the Gospel of Luke. Peter is usually the one to speak up first, and he's often the loudest. It's possible that's, again, the case. But notice what he says here in verses 31 to 34 to Peter. I think the first time I read this, I don't know if I thought Jesus was cruel, but I don't know if I ever saw the kindness that Jesus gives Peter here. 31, Simon, or Peter, his second name given by Jesus. Behold, Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers. Peter said to him, Lord, I'm ready to go with you both to prison and to death. Jesus said, I tell you, Peter, you're going to deny me three times, and then a rooster is going to crow. And you're going to cry like you've never cried before. Notice, Satan has to ask God's permission. It's the same case in Job chapters 1 and 2. And we were reminded of this last week. Christian, Satan has no rights over you. He doesn't. He can try to trip you up, and he is a lion that's prowling, as Peter says, and Peter knows. But there is assurance to be had, and Jesus gives it here to Peter. So, Peter, Satan wanted you. He wanted to sift you like wheat. And I don't think that means physical torment, but rather the spiritual. He wanted to take every ounce of Peter's faith away, every last drop, and leave him destitute, distraught, unable to understand how it is that Jesus would die within the next 24 hours or less. But, what a great but, verse 32, but I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. Peter stumbles. We know this, who've heard the gospel accounts many times over. Peter does indeed deny three times. We'll read this on Good Friday. And the cock crows, the rooster crows, and Peter's just distraught. He realizes what he's done. And he even told Jesus with his own lips, I won't deny you. I'll go to death for you. And he gave in to fear and cowardice and was crushed with his failure. But notice, Peter, I prayed for you that your faith may not fail in the ultimate sense. It fails there. But these words, you have to wonder how many times Peter mulled them over and they gave him encouragement, especially after he saw Jesus in the flesh. And notice how effective Jesus' prayers are, friends. Jesus prayed and Peter did not ultimately reject Jesus. He did for a moment there. He faltered, he stumbled, but he is the rock of the church, the greatest of the apostles. And then he gives him two more, if you will, assignments. One, I think, really both somewhat prophetic. When you have turned again. So in other words, Peter, when you've repented, when you've confessed your lack of faith and your faltering, go strengthen your brothers. And if we had more time, we could go to the end of John's gospel and see Peter and Jesus interchange, where Jesus continually says, feed my sheep, care for my flock, Peter. And he reinstitutes and encourages Peter afresh. Peter probably doesn't understand much of this, but he needs this not now, he needs this later. Jesus doesn't equip him to resist and successfully not deny him. He equips him to recover from his failed faith, to repent, and to begin following him anew. Last but not least, we see in these final four verses, Jesus is the suffering servant. And that is the greatest example of how God's view of greatness is the opposite of man's. Verse 35. And Jesus said to them, when I sent you out with no money bag or knapsack or sandals, did you lack anything? They said, no, nothing. And then he says, well, let's pause real quick there. Twice prior to this, Jesus sent his disciples out in chapter 9 and chapter 10. And he told them, don't bring anything with you. And the point was then, and it's obvious now, they needed to experience God's provision. God can provide money for you, future missionary. God can provide the clothes on your back. He does right now. We just think we do, silly people. He can provide shelter and food for you. He does for the disciples over and over again as they go out in pairs and groups to share the good news. And pastors and missionaries centuries on have found God to be more than able to provide for their needs. Our command is to go, not to provide what God wants to provide for us. So Jesus says, you know, those two times, were you provided for? Absolutely. Okay, this time is different. Verse 36, but now, there's a but again, by contrast, but now let the one who has a money bag take it. Bring your knapsack too, your extra cloak. And if you've got more than one, sell it for a sword. Well, why? Because things have changed. I, your master, am going to suffer. They're going to persecute me. You better believe if they come after the master, they're going to come after you. And we see the disciples in the moments up until the resurrection. They scatter. They convene in private dwellings. They don't go out in public. They are hiding. They're bunkering down. They're worried for their very lives. They're on their own, or at least they feel that way. But more importantly than his instructions is what Jesus says in verse 37 and 38. For I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in me, and he was numbered with the transgressors. For what is written about me has its fulfillment. Now, you've heard me say this before. When the New Testament quotes the Old Testament, it assumes all of the context and the themes with it. It's just like when you and I quote a book or a movie or a poem. One line can bring the whole thing back to our memory. Let me give you an example. O captain, my captain, our fearful trip is done. Now, if you know the poem, it's written by Walt Whitman. And it's not a happy poem. Just by hearing those words, some of us remember the sorrow embedded in that poem. Let me read more of it. The ship has weathered every rack. The prize we sought is won. The port is near, the bells I hear, the people all exulting. While follow eyes the steady keel, the vessel grim and daring. But oh, heart, 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 oh, the bleeding drops of red, where on the deck my captain lies, fallen cold and dead. Walt Whitman wrote this poem after the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. That's just the first stanza. When we quote one passage, it ports in everything around it. And if we thought that Walt Whitman's poem, which is beautiful and is a very great tribute to our great president and all that he stood for at the Civil War and for the freedom of the slaves, then I want you to know I think this passage in Isaiah is even all the greater. Because Jesus is saying to his disciples and to you and I am the suffering servant. You've called me the Messiah, that is true. And I've told you, I'm the Son of Man from Daniel, but I'm also the suffering servant from Isaiah. We'll read a few verses, Isaiah 52, starting in verse 13. This is written some 600 or plus years before Jesus came. Behold, my servant, this is Jesus, shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. His appearance was so marred by his beatings. Beyond human semblance, Jesus looked more like a zombie than he did a human. But verse 15, so shall he sprinkle many nations with his blood. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them they see, and that which they have not heard they understand. So we have a foreshadowing of Jesus' death, his suffering, and that his blood will cover not only Israel as their Passover lamb, but any king or citizen of another country. Skipping a little bit ahead to verse 53, or chapter 53, verses 10 through 12, where our passage is taken from. Yet it was the will of the Lord, Yahweh, to crush Jesus. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant Jesus, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death, and he was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Jesus is pictured here as great and mighty, and yet one who suffers with sinners and for them. And through his suffering, others can be accounted righteous. In other words, Jesus shares his righteousness with anyone by faith. Luther called it the great exchange. And Isaiah is giving us the foretaste of this, and Jesus shows us on the cross. He lays down his life, and all we must do is give him our sin, give him our lives, and he will exchange. He'll take all of our account, everything we've done, the things that people know about, the things that only God knows about. And Jesus will take them on himself and give us his clean slate, his white robes for our black robes. Why? Because, friends, there is no one greater than Jesus. The suffering servant, by God's own account, is the measure of greatness in this world. In closing, Jesus turns greatness on his head. And we as Christians, therefore, can never find ourselves standing over others as if we're greater. Rather, we stand under he who is greatest. There's no room for you and I to look down on anybody. For without Jesus, we've all inherited a one-way ticket to hell. Without Jesus, there'd be no hope. So therefore, we who have that hope should continue to grow in humility and not in long noses that look down on others. Two, notice the perseverance required. Notice the faith that we need. Friends, it's the opposite of worldly wisdom. It's the simplicity of a child who trusts his father and knows that his father will take care of him. A vague belief here, friends, in God isn't going to cut it. A specific belief in Jesus is what's required. It's exclusive. Yeah, you're right. There is only one way. If you remember, Jesus said to his apostles, what the Father gives me, I will then share with you. Friends, if you try to get to the Father any other way through Jesus, you're not getting his inheritance. You're finding something else, and it's a false road leading to an eternity of regret and suffering. But the good news embedded here, and we will fully understand it more, we will more fully understand it on Good Friday and Easter this next weekend. But Jesus is the suffering servant, friends. Family, he can save you once and for all. He doesn't need to be re-sacrificed. Once was enough, Hebrews tells us. And he was counted among us who are liars, cheaters, adulterers, men and women full of anger and spite, cynical over any real truth. Some of us in our minds and maybe in our actions are addicts. Some of us in our minds and maybe in our actions have been rapists, pedophiles, prostitutes, and more. Friends, Jesus numbers himself with us. He identifies with us to bring us through faith in him to the forgiveness of sins and the resurrection from the dead. For he knew no sin. He could be our sacrifice on our stead to buy for us what we could never, ever hope to buy on our own. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you that before time began, you purposed, knowing all that would happen. Thank you that you purposed to come and walk among us, to identify with us, not to stay with us, but to bring us with you. You've seen the inside of our hearts. You know the crime, the wickedness, the evil, the murder, the unfaithfulness, and the list goes on. And yet you still chose to come because your love is so great that you, rather than lording your perfection over us, you lay down your life for us. Jesus, you're the greatest servant. May we respond this day freshly with faith, telling you our sins, sharing with you so that you can forgive us again, as you have promised to do. And if for the first time, Lord, give us the faith that we need, the grace that we need to believe and to put our hope in you, and the faith to persevere until that day where you shall call us and say to us, well done, good and faithful servant. We pray all these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.